Hope you're all doing well, and welcome back to Machines and More. I'm glad to hear that some of you are finally getting your NR200s, and that's really exciting, so happy building. I was working on the content for this video prior to the 3080 project began, so I figured I would get this out and then continue working through the 3080 related SFF content. So, as many of you are aware, there was a recent Gamers Nexus expose on the problems with bottom mounting AAO radiators. Primarily, the problem was caused by inevitable air pockets in the cooler, which became a problem when the combination pump CPU block was placed higher than the radiator. Not only did this lead to potential sloshing sounds in the unit, it also led to the pump running partially dry, possibly leading to early pump failure. Now, one thing you should be aware of is that the warranty on a unit like NZXT's X53 lasts 6 years, so if you manage to fry the pump before that time elapses, chances are it's a warrantyable issue. Of course, even if you're willing to take that calculated risk, the potential downtime, potential noise, and reduced cooler performance is still a legitimate concern. It's worth noting this video because Gamers Nexus did specifically call out the NR200P. The NR200 has two radiator mounting locations. You can either side mount it or you can bottom mount it with a vertical GPU. In the NR200P, however, since the main difference is that tempered glass panel, you pretty much have one option, and that's to mount it on the bottom. This also means vertical mounting the GPU. So this video has two main points of discussion. The first is a mini review of a viable AIO unit that mitigates those radiator mounting concerns. And the second relates to GPU thermals and AIO thermals with a vertically mounted GPU. The unit I have here today is MSI's Core Liquid 240R, which is MSI's first foray into the world of liquid coolers. I actually purchased the cooler when it was released back in June, well before the NR200 was announced, but I haven't really had a chance to appreciate its rather unique design until now. The reason this cooler is well suited to bottom mounting is because unlike Asetek or ID cooling units where the pump is in the CPU block, this one has its pump mounted in the radiator itself. Now, because that pump is in the radiator, it won't run dry when used in the bottom position. The other thing is that this design allows MSI to fill it to the brim and bleed out the air properly, so much so that I couldn't hear as much as a little slosh when shaking the unit. So, well done on that, MSI. Because of that fill level, I would feel comfortable running this radiator wherever your case allows it. Now, I will also say up front that this cooler still has some refinements needed to make it a true competitor against something like the NZXT Kraken X53. But let's take a look and see how else it could add value to your build. First off, this unit is really, really RGB focused. The fans are ARGB capable, and if you want that lighting, you'll daisy chain everything, including the CPU block, back to your motherboard's ARGB header, where you can then control that lighting pattern through your motherboard software. The head unit is rotatable, so you can choose the best location to mount your pump block, which is really important on a mini ITX board, and then just rotate that MSI Dragon to how you like it. Of course, on the NR200, you won't ever see the pump block, so that's not of primary importance if you're looking to install it in one. The cooler also has very beefy tubing. With the braiding, it's about 13 millimeters in diameter, whereas the Kraken series has tubing that's about 10 millimeters. It's possible that the thicker tubing diameter will help with reducing permeation, and MSI claims it all but eliminates it, but you wouldn't be able to validate that claim for years. The radiator and fan mounting screws were also some of the nicest ones I have seen, featuring a nickel-like polish. However, the finish quality on the remaining parts of the cooler seemed a step below the Kraken unit, with paint missing on the radiator parts and also a lower quality feel to the mounting brackets. Which leads us to the other cons on this unit. So first off, I did not like these fans. There was too much emphasis placed on making them look good instead of performing well. There's way too much play in the fan axle, and this led to strange noises while running, and I think one of these did have a bad bearing as it had a repetitive, annoying sound that crept up when it spun fast. After initial CPU-only testing, I ended up taking them off and using them as the case fans, because the sound was really annoying and it wasn't the sort of thing that a decibel meter would pick up. I could then run them at a lower RPM as case fans, and I just picked a Noctua P12 Redux as a similar substitute for the rad fans. They definitely have a more consistent noise pattern. The next thing is that the pump block, while innovative. Did not allow for speed control. It runs off the fan header for power, but cannot be controlled, and it runs at a constant 4200 RPM. It basically ran at one speed the entire time, and there was a very slight hum if you put your ear close to it. I couldn't hear it though when it was mounted in the case. The last thing was that the mounting design for AMD CPUs needs work, and more on that shortly in the performance results. So all this is secondary to how the unit performs, right? Against the Kraken X52, in like-for-like combined GPU and CPU testing on a 3700X, when mounted as a side intake on the side panel, the performance gap is about 4 degrees. Bottom mounting the radiator as a bottom intake is worse in general for AIOs in the NR200 due to the reduced airflow path under the case. With a simulated solid panel, the penalty for mounting the unit on the bottom is a little less than a degree, and with the mesh panel, 1.8 degrees. The reason a solid panel is better is because of the better defined airflow pattern that a solid panel allows, and this means that the top exhausts are directly helping to draw the exhaust off the radiator, instead of partially just channeling in cool air through the side panel just to exhaust it off immediately. When vertically mounting the GPU in the NR200, you're also limited to about 75 millimeters of cooler height, and even if you could stick one of the low profile coolers that I recently reviewed behind the GPU, you are drawing air from a blocked off area, and to make things worse, possibly the highest source of exhausted heat in your system. So air coolers in theory aren't a great idea with a vertical GPU. I use the same 6060 Super GPU just to stay consistent with the earlier tests. As a quick comparison, a horizontal 1660 Super with bottom fans performs about a degree better than vertically mounted on the side, indicating that the bottom fans do more than just offset the deficit from the limited bottom airflow. A solid panel, simulating the NR200P's glass panel, leads to a fairly significant deficit of about 5 degrees over the horizontal option. Now, this will include both penalty from drawing some radiator exhaust, and more critically, having a limited airflow path. So if you want to vertically mount your GPU, the bottom mounted option with this cooler does result in some deficiencies compared to mesh panel setups. In this scenario, the delta is about 5.2 degrees against the side mounted X52. So when I checked the install with the thermal paste, I saw that the CPU block wasn't actually making very good contact with the Ryzen CPU, and this was evidenced by the pooling of thermal paste on the edges, even with really solid and tight mounting tension. So the cause of this may be the reliance on the stock motherboard mounting hardware, which might be okay for a stock air cooler, but for this round pump block with an adapter disc, a two-point mounting solution at the middle of the pump block is just asking for uneven pressure. This is part of the reason for poor thermal transfer. Which brings us to the Intel CPU test, where the deficit against a Kraken 240mm unit is still there, but not as bad. The Intel mounting solution uses a fairly common four-point mount, still leading to some unevenness, but it wasn't nearly as severe. I do think the shape of the cold plate needs to be fine-tuned, as well as a revision to the mounting bracket. With an i9-10850K clocked at 4.8 GHz on all cores, and on the stock MSI fans, it only performed 4 degrees worse than the Kraken X53 in open air. But keep in mind that this is a much smaller percentage gap due to the much hotter Comet Lake 10-core chip. So, where's the bulk of the performance gap from? This is the obvious one, the 47mm by 47mm pump block that's blocked off on the radiator simply means there's less surface area for heat exchange. Now, assuming that your typical 240 rad has a total surface area of a little less than 120 by 240mm, this equates to about 8% less surface area. Now, MSI's unit has a slightly thicker radiator at 27mm versus 25mm on the Kraken, so that is offset somewhat, but more radiator surface space always beats more radiator thickness. The delta is in line with what you would expect in a situation like this though. So MSI did strategically place the block where the cooled liquid flows back out, but the impact is there nonetheless. Regardless of liquid temperature, that surface area lost for heat exchange. Unless the cool liquid is already equalized to the ambient temperature, which it rarely is, then that is a missed opportunity for heat exchange. Now, to be fair, this isn't a bad unit, and the looks of the unit as a whole could subjectively be considered one of the most eye-catching on the market. If you're going for the tempered glass panel and you want lighting, then this is much better than the NZXT unit, since the MSI is capable of being hooked up to your motherboard's addressable RGB headers. Certainly, comparing thermals against one of the best AIOs on the market is a tall order. Corsair's H110i Pro, which is an Ace Tech unit featuring ARGB lighting, is considerably more expensive than MSI's. The MSI's main advantage is the radiator mounting flexibility. If it weren't for that subpar fan noise and the poor CPU contact, I think this would be an easy recommendation, but as such, I can only recommend it for one purpose, bottom mounting your radiator. If you're using this unit for bottom mounting, I'd upgrade the fans as soon as possible, since these RGB fans do more at the top anyway for aesthetics, and you don't really want to run these stock fans at a high RPM. That this is MSI's maiden voyage into liquid cooling is fairly evident, however, it's a decent one, and I would look forward to seeing what improvements they can make on their future revisions, at least on the performance side of things. If it were between this unit working at a few degrees worse, and listening to a constantly sloshy and noisy CPU pump block, I would gladly choose the MSI Core Liquid unit. Having dealt with a sloshy and buzzy X52 pump unit before, I can tell you that the gushing sound is way more noticeable than any fan noise because it's always going to be like that, regardless of whether the system is idling or at load. So there you have it, some food for thought when it comes to the NR200P and vertical GPU AIO options. I don't think there's too much reason to vertically mount your GPU when using the mesh panel, since the side panel really is the most ideal location to mount your AIO. So as I'm growing the channel, I really appreciate your insightful comments and your support in subscribing, liking the videos, and using some of the product links down below. I'll be back next with some more sweet 3080 goodness in the case, so stay tuned to the channel for that. Thanks so much for watching, and happy building to all of you that have the case now.